Welcome back to another episode of Andrew Reviews. I'm your host, Andrew Ambrose, and I hope you're having a fantastic day. Now, if there's one thing us gamers love to do, it's shooting stuff. And in the 80s, there were plenty of opportunities to do such a thing, mainly thanks in part to scrolling shooting games, or as some of you out there like to call them, shmups. Most of these games involved you piloting some sort of flying aircraft over land and sea, like in Namco's Zevius, or piloting some sort of flying spacecraft through outer space, like in Konami's Gradius. But there were those few lone wolves out there who distinguished themselves from the rest of the pack by having you controlling a person moving along the ground and shooting at things, and one such title was Capcom's NES classic Gun.Smoke. The history of Gun.Smoke starts with the Gun.Smoke arcade game developed and released by Capcom back in late 1985. Capcom had already made a bit of a name of themselves for making successful scrolling shooting games at this point, and Gun.Smoke was no exception. Hell, it was actually pretty unique at the time for its multi-directional firing system and Wild West setting. The same year they put out Gun.Smoke to arcades, Capcom began publishing titles for Nintendo's Famicom and subsequently bringing said titles to the West via the NES about a year later. Originally, these were just basic ports of their popular arcade titles, but Capcom started getting a bit more creative around 1987 and instead started making games that expanded upon the original arcade titles and sometimes even made straight-up sequels or follow-ups. Gun.Smoke was no exception to this, as Capcom would produce an expanded Gun.Smoke game for the Famicom Disk System and NES. The Disk System Gun.Smoke game released in Japan in January of 1988, with its NES counterpart releasing to the United States about a month later. While I'm not sure how well the Disk System game did in Japan, I do know that the NES Gun.Smoke game sold pretty damn well in America, and it was well praised by gamers and publications of the time. However, and but unfortunately, Capcom never bothered following up either the arcade game or the NES game. They did start work on a spiritual successor to Gun.Smoke in the early 2000s called Red Dead Revolver, but after Yoshiki Okamoto, the designer of the original Gun.Smoke, left Capcom in 2003, the project was cancelled. Thankfully, this story is happy end, as the legendary Rockstar Games would buy the rights to the game from Capcom, finish it themselves, and release it in 2004 for Xbox and Sony PlayStation 2. They would then go on to produce two sequels for it, Red Dead Redemption in 2010 and Red Dead Redemption 2 in 2018, which were both tremendously successful and to this day are still beloved by millions of fans all over. So essentially, you can pretty much thank Gun.Smoke for giving us the Red Dead series. But as for playing this NES classic for yourself, it's unfortunately not received any sort of re-release on any of Nintendo's virtual console services, and it's currently not on NES Online for Nintendo Switch. And the only official re-release I know that's happened is via the god-awful Retrobit Generations from 2016. So in this instance, your best option is either an original NES copy, which shouldn't cost you too much as the game is fairly common, or an emulator if you can't play NES games. I don't own an original NES copy of this game, though I do hope to get one sometime in the future, so I'll be using the Wii's FCEUGX emulator for the purposes of this review. Haven't had to do that in a while. Either way, let's saddle up and prepare for a hectic yet pleasurable ride as we take a look at Gun.Smoke for the NES. An opening sequence sets the stage for the game about to unfold. It's the year 1849, the start of the gold rush, and the small town of Hicksville is in a dire situation, as the vicious outlaw gang known as the Wingates have invaded the town, murdered the sheriff, and took control, causing mass terror. Thankfully, not all hope is lost for the poor citizens of Hicksville, as one lone gunman has arrived on the scene to save them all from the wicked Wingates, Billy Bob. You control Billy Bob through six perilous stages, shooting down waves of bad guys and avoiding their projectile attacks. Billy is able to shoot his two pistols in three different directions, off to the left by pushing B, off to the right by pushing A, and straight in front by pushing A and B together. Many of the outlaws you gun down will drop boot emblems, rifle emblems, bullets, and bags of money, which can also be uncovered in the various barrels littered throughout. The boot emblems increase Billy's walking speed, and the rifle emblems increase Billy's firing distance. You'll also find some classic Capcom power-ups along the ground, too. Those being the POW emblem that will instantly kill all the enemies present on the screen, and blue and red variants of the Ashichi. If you're familiar with the original Mega Man, Mega Man 10, or some of Capcom's other early arcade classics, you'll definitely recognize the Ashichi, which first appeared as an enemy in Vulgus, but otherwise shows up as a very helpful item in other games. In this game, the red Yashichis give you an extra life, and the blue Yashichis make Billy temporarily invincible. However, take extreme caution with the Cattle Skulls, as these will take away one of Billy's boot and rifle emblems, and thus reducing his speed and firing distance. Near the end of each stage, there's a wanted poster that must be uncovered by firing 8 shots at a specific location, and then collected in order to fight the boss of the stage. Said wanted poster is shown at the start of each stage with a picture of the boss, their name, their weapon, and their bounty that you collect for defeating them at the end of the stage. Speaking of which, the points you collect for gunning down outlaws are actually currency in this game, as you'll occasionally come across Hicksville citizens who will graciously sell you various items and power-ups to help you out. They mainly sell special weapons that use the bullets you collect throughout the game, and they can be selected by pulling up the inventory screen with the select button. The shotgun allows Billy to fire a spread of 5 bullets simultaneously, really great for crowd control. The machine gun greatly increases the speed of Billy's firing, very handy for when you need to get out more shots quicker. And the Magnum, fires off bullets that are more powerful than the regular ones, useful for dealing larger amounts of damage in an instant. You can also buy a horse that will take extra hits for Billy, which is great since he normally dies in a single hit. And even a wanted poster so you don't have to worry about looking for the one hidden in the stage. What's especially great about buying a wanted poster is that it'll carry over to the next stage if you've already collected the hidden poster for the current stage. That's pretty much it for how the game itself plays, so now I want to cover each of the stages individually and go over some specifics. Stage 1 is the town of Hicksville itself. You'll mainly encounter outlaws firing at you on the ground and out of windows, plus these outlaws who throw sticks of dynamite. The dynamite can actually be collected for some extra points, but it will detonate if you wait too long. You'll also encounter these blue outlaws who jump around a lot and try to stab you, but they can be taken out during the short time they're on the ground. This stage's boss is the rifle-wielding Bandit Bill. He's fairly easy to take out, especially if you use the shotgun like I did. Stage 2 is this desolate area filled with cacti and large plateaus, and you'll encounter more gunmen, dynamite throwers, and knife wielders. The boss is Cutter Boomerang, and he lives up to his namesake by using boomerangs as his weapon. Wait a minute. We have here a boss whose name has the word cut in it, and he uses some sort of boomerang as his main weapon. And this is a Capcom game. On the NES. Anyways, this guy is also fairly easy to take out with your regular pistols, as long as you carefully watch out for his boomerangs, but definitely consider using the Magnum for more powerful shots. Stage 3 is the Comanche Village, and you now have to deal with natives firing arrows and bullets, some of them hiding out in huts. The boss is the leader of the natives, Devil Hawk, and his main attack is throwing waves of fireballs. He's also fairly easy to take out with your normal weaponry, so the Magnum is once again ideal here if you've got the ammo for it. Stage 4, Death Mountain, is where the game starts to get harder. You now have to deal with ninjas, gunmen firing out of the side of the mountain, and boulders rolling down said side of the mountain. Also, enemies will start entering from the bottom of the screen, so you'll have to carefully circumvent them since Billy can't fire backwards. The boss of this stage is, I kid you not, Ninja. He doesn't even get a more specific name, it's just Ninja. What the hell? This guy jumps around, vanishes, and reappears while throwing these white projectiles that split into 4 upon impact. He's a bit tougher than the previous bosses, but the shotgun helps in the fight against him. Stage 5 is the Cheyenne River, and it's pretty straightforward, though it's worth noting the large bodies of water that slow Billy's movement. The boss is Fat Man Joe, whose weapon is the aptly named Bomb Gun. He's pretty easy as long as you remember to keep far away from his bombs, and the Magnum is best used to do away with them. And then there's the climactic final stage, Fort Wingate. My god, this stage. First off, it's very different from all the other stages visually, as there's barely any organic terrain. You'll mostly see the walls of the fort, a ground of white bricks, and countless gravestones. But the more notable thing about the stage is its immense difficulty. It's the hardest stage in the entire game, and considerably harder than any of the stages that came prior to it. It throws pretty much everything but the kitchen sink at you, and you will die and continue numerous times just trying to get through it. It took me about 40 minutes to beat this whole game, and half of that time was spent on this stage alone. But if you can keep on going like I did and sharpen your skills enough to make it to the end, you'll face off against the head honcho himself, Wingate. Wingate is pretty damn tough, and appropriately the hardest boss in the game. He wields a machine gun that constantly fires shots at Billy, which with the addition of all of his men attacking, makes for a pretty intense battle. You pretty much have to use as much of your whole arsenal as you can in order to defeat him. And what's more, you have to fight him not once, but twice before he actually goes down for the count. Truly, a textbook example of a final stage. This game's graphics are pretty sweet. There's some nice oranges, greens, and blues used mostly, and the Wild West set pieces are well drawn. The characters are also well drawn too, and you never have a moment where it's hard to see where the projectiles and other dangers are on the screen. Major props to the Capcom devs for their work on this game's visuals. And speaking of major props, this game's soundtrack is fantastic! It was done by the legendary Junko Tamiya, who you might also know for doing the soundtracks for Strider and NES Bionic Commando. This game's soundtrack is pretty much just as awesome as in those other two games. You've actually been listening to some of this game's soundtrack throughout this review, but here are some more highlight tracks from the game. All in all, it's a solid Capcom soundtrack. Great work, Junko. But you're probably all wondering what I think of the game itself, though. Well, I love it! A damn fine shooting game, especially for one on the NES. The multi-directional firing system in particular is what makes Gunsmoke so fun to play, as you have a great sense of control of your situation when being able to attack enemies coming from most directions. I don't know of any other scrolling shooting games that use this type of firing system, but it's so well done here that I wish Capcom would have made more games that used it, and maybe even expanded upon it. And like this firing system, the game having you control someone moving along the ground makes it quite unique and a pretty nice change of pace for the genre. The only other scrolling shooting games I can think of that have a similar style of play are Konami's Nightmare for MSX and Compile's Alesta Gaiden for MSX2. And it'd be pretty cool to see more games of this genre done in this same fashion. This game is also made fun with its shop system and sub-weapons, since it makes your points more valuable than in most home console games of the time, and thus gives you more incentive to rack up a good score. Not to mention, those sub-weapons are very helpful and just as satisfying to use. I also just really love this game's level of challenge. The game isn't all that long, having only 6 stages, but the difficulty gets quite intense while still being fair. You ever have those hard games that you like, but barely come back to out of reluctance to face the rough challenge all over again? Well, Gunsmoke's difficulty is enough to give you a great challenge while making you want to come back for more. I beat this game for the very first time for the sake of this review, but I still want to pick up an actual cartridge of it to play more, despite already beating it in an emulator. I believe that demonstrates how well crafted the challenge is in Gunsmoke. With responsive controls, great music, challenging yet fun difficulty, Gunsmoke for the NES is an absolute winner, and I highly implore you guys to go and check it out for yourselves. And despite the lack of any official modern console or handheld re-release, the original cartridge of the game should be fairly easy and affordable to come by. But I'm hoping that they'll make this NES classic available on modern platforms soon, as it really deserves to be enjoyed by a lot more people. Hell, the NES online service for Nintendo Switch could really use this game, as it's severely lacking in classic scrolling shooting games. But either way, Gunsmoke for the NES gets an approval from me. I hope you guys enjoyed this review, and I hope to see you guys for the next one, or whatever new video I decide to put out next. And as always, thank you everybody for watching. I'm Andrew Ambrose, and I'll catch you later.